All right, welcome to an HK session. I'm Kenji Kohno, moderator for today. And today's topic is the prosperity in the age of longevity. Now, in the midst of the remarkable period in the history of mankind, as you see on the screen behind you, the world life expectancy. Now, the global population is living much, much longer than ever before we experienced in history. Now, if this trend continues, some experts predict that the children who were born in 2007 are likely to live up to 100 or even more, you believe it or not. So this demographic change or the growing aging population is making a great impact on our lives in many areas such as work, health, and lifestyle, right? But at the same time, we are already having heavy challenges such as pension crisis, exploding healthcare costs, but they are just some example of them. Now, so the question today is, what happens if living to 100 becomes the norm? And are we ready for it? To discuss this, we have the great panel here today. Let me introduce first Professor Lynda Gratton to my immediate right. And Professor Gratton is a professor of management practice, London Business School, and she is the author of that famous bestseller, 100 Year Life, Living and Working in the Age of Longevity. Right. Next to her is Mr. Yasuhiro Sato. He is the president and group CEO of Mizuho Financial Group, which is the largest financial group in Japan. And he was also the key member of the Japanese government advisory committee on aging. And next to him is Mr. William Morneau. Is correct yes, pronunciation?
Perfect.
Okay. Yeah. Of course, he's a Minister of Finance of Canada, but he was also the executive chair of the Canada's largest human resources firm. And he has co-authored a book titled Real Retirement. And last but not least is Dr. David Agus. He's a professor of medicine and engineering at the University of Southern California. And Dr. Agus is a world-leading cancer specialist. Actually, he was a doctor for Steve Jobs. And he has published a lot of books, but his most recent bestseller is The Lucky Years, How to Thrive in the Brave New World of Health. Now, let me start off with you, Dr. Agus. We see this life expectancy is getting longer, and it doesn't seem like it's going to be changed very soon. Now, as your medical expert, how far do you think this goes on? And what factors have led us to this current longer life expectancy?
So what's interesting, that curve you showed a few minutes ago, showing it going like this,
yes.
Most of the gains are we got rid of death in the first few years. So mm-hmm. childhood, you know, people dying at a very young age, children. Mm-hmm. And so we're now starting to make gains at the other end. And I think that's what gets us all excited.
Yes.
The human body wasn't engineered to live until age 200. The human body wasn't engineered until 100. And yet we're going to be able to live there. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have to make new medical advances to allow us to live longer. You know, in the 1950s, an amazing experiment was done by this woman named Wanda Ruth Lunsford. It was the only experiment she ever did, and she was kicked out of science. She took an old rat and a young rat, she put them to sleep, and she tied their skin together. And after about a day, their blood supplies joined, and then she looked 4 weeks later, the gray hairs had turned brown again, the heartbeat stronger in the old rat, there were new neurons in the brain, and the muscles were bigger. She claimed she reversed aging. Well, they called her Dracula and Frankenstein, and they kicked her out of science.
She did.
Well, last year, three labs at Harvard, at Stanford, the University of California, San Francisco, repeated Wanda's experiment, and it worked. And what they showed in journals Medical Nature, I mean, in Nature and Science, is that there's stem cells in each of us that go to sleep at age 25. And there are now proteins that can turn them back on. Mm-hmm. And so the notion of being able to reawaken those stem cells to re-energize those organs that are engineered to kind of go in 80s, 90s, or 100 really makes it possible that we can live until about 120.
120?
Yeah.
Wow. That sounds very interesting.
Are you going to sign up? Is that?
Yeah, sure. Interesting. Professor Gratton, yeah. In your book, in the 100-year yeah. life, yeah. you mentioned that the three-staged life,
yes.
right, starting with education, yeah. work, and retirement. This lifestyle is not going to be working anymore in the future. Yeah. Is that what you said? Why is that?
Well, imagine you live to 100 or even 120. We haven't done the economics for that. When we did it for 100, it was scary enough. I wrote the book. I'm a psychologist. I wrote it with an economist. And the first thing we did was to work out, you know, in terms of your saving rates and how much you want to retire on and so on, how long do you have to work? And I don't know how long you think you're going to have to work if you live to 100, but you basically have to work until you're in your 80s. So if you think about full-time education, full-time work, full-time retirement, the three-stage life is obviously completely ridiculous. And you need to think about a multi-stage life where education becomes a lifelong event, a life where the work isn't just about full-time work. It's also maybe about exploring. It's maybe about, you know, building your own business. It's maybe about building a portfolio. And retirement becomes maybe a word you don't even hear anymore.
Yes. All right.
Yeah. So we think it's the end of the three-stage life. I think that individuals are beginning to realize that. Mm-hmm. Corporations aren't, and governments aren't either. So there's a huge amount of catching up. We actually believe that there will be a fundamental transformation in life, and we, our generation and our children, will have to achieve that. You know, they'll have to think about relationships, you know, the 80-year-old marriage. All of this has got to be thought through. So we're in a time of just extraordinary excitement, but also, as you will say, in terms of inequality, of course, major challenges.
Mm. Okay. Mr. Sato, you are the business leader from Japan, and Japan is sort of like a front runner of the so-called super age nation. And I believe the people over 65 years old make up 27% of the whole population. Right? What kind of issues do you think that Japan is facing or will be facing in with this aging population?
Yeah, okay. I think that this kind of longevity of society is not a sort of hypothetical problems for Japan. It's a now reality. And I think year 2000 years, the centenarians in Japan was just about 10,000, about that. But year 2015, it's going to be 60,000. And there is the statistics, the within 2050, it's going to be 600,000 or 700,000. Mm-hmm. So having said that, I think this longevity of society is the real current issues for the Japanese society. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to touch upon the four major issues facing the this society. One is that lack of the working population. It's in some extent related to the low birth ratio, but this is very significant. Year 2000 years, the working population was just about 77 million people, but it's going to be 50 million in 2050. We will lose the 30% of the working population. And somebody said that technology will help it. This is true, but this is not true. In terms of the quantitative approach of the working population, the answer is yes. But the qualitative approach, this is huge amount of the mismatch of the working population. That's one first issue. The second one is that social security system. Now, I think in Japan, total social security expenses in 2014 was just about $1 trillion. But within 2050, it's going to be $1.5 trillion. So huge increase, which create the significant uncertainty in the society. That's the second part. Mm. And third one is that wealth disparity, inequality. We have many the elderly people who is in the very poor position because they have been saving money, but they live more than their expectation. Mm. So having said that, they are losing the enough room of the saving. So this creates another issue, which is the not wealth disparity, health disparity is also very significant issues. This is kind of the negative circle, starting from wealth disparity and to go into the bad health condition and may not be able to receive the appropriate treatment, then create the another low productivity, then further wealth disparity. This kind of the negative circle will be a significant issue. The last one is a so-called silver democracy in Japan.
It's familiar with that, silver democracy.
Which is Japanese English, isn't it? So which means that the elder people has right to vote, okay? The number of the elderly is gonna be increased. The government has to take care of the elder people. So which means that they are going to take an action to have support policy to, rather than the elderly people, rather than the younger generation, which creates the significant and deepened risk for the future. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of four big issues now we are facing. I think the Japanese government understand that, and Mr. Abe, Prime Minister, is now taking action to take care of that. But this is not the Japan's issue. This is the issue for every country, whatever the political system is.
Thank you. That's a great summary of what's happening in the front runner of the super age nation. And Canada, I believe, is going to be super age nation by 2030, according to one of our WEF reports. Now, I wonder what kind of impact or challenges you expect to see in Canada, especially in the area of government you work for, in the pension and the social cost here.
Well, I guess just first of all, to agree with your starting point, last year in Canada, we hit an important tipping point where we had more Canadians over the age of 65 than we had under the age of 15. So that was the first time for us that had happened. We in Canada are facing the same sort of retirement challenges as other industrialized countries. We have a decline in workforce or workplace pension plans that's been significant. We have, you know, aging population and obviously low interest rates make it very difficult for people to save. So from a government standpoint, we look at this and say there's both issues during people's working lives that we need to think about along the lines of what Professor Gratton was talking about, and issues about how we deal with people's anxiety around what's going to happen as they get older. So from our perspective, we're thinking about it in those two separate areas. In terms of in people's working lives, we're thinking very much about how do we train and retrain people? How do we get information to Canadians about what their opportunities are in work? And how do we think about the world of education and training in new ways? So recognizing that that the pattern of having an education just until you're 20 or 21 or 22 and then leaving that aside is not going to be long-term effective for people who have long working careers. We're thinking about how we can work collaboratively in our environment with our provinces to come up with new ways to train Canadians so they can be prepared for their second and third and fourth career iteration. We're also then thinking about how the government can lessen anxiety around retirement. So we've been in government for a year and a bit, and we've already made some fairly significant changes. We took our Canada pension plan, which has been very successful in alleviating poverty over the last generation, and we got to an agreement with our provinces to significantly enhance that plan. So we're doing that in a way that's going to be fully funded, which means it'll take 40 years to get there. But that means for the youngest of Canadians, those entering the workforce now, they have the likelihood, instead of having 25% coverage, of 33% coverage at the end of a 40-year trajectory. We've also then increased the what we call the guaranteed income supplement for the most impoverished of Canadian seniors to deal with immediate challenges for that group, which is really along the lines of what you were saying in terms of the reality from an electoral standpoint of dealing with the elderly who are concerned about their situation. So for us, it will be thinking about how we can enhance people's effectiveness during the course of their life, and then as a government, recognizing those workplace pension plans that have been eroded, thinking about how we can create a support system underneath. That will be an ongoing challenge on both fronts. Probably the former front being, frankly, more challenging than the latter, thinking about how we can help people to stay employed in work that they get energized by during the course of their career, which is increasingly challenging as we see technological change create issues for people.
I see. Yeah, the supporting system could be very difficult to deal with. Now, the financial matters. And you think, Professor Gratton, the people have to delay the retirement and work into 70s, 80s, or that to somehow mitigate the financial burden of the country?
Yes, I mean, there's just no way around it, actually, and it's great that I can say it because I'm a professor and you're a politician, so you're not going to be able to say that, but it's just the truth. I mean, you just work it out economically, and people will have to work a great deal longer. How are they going to do that? Well, I think, you know, in the past, we've looked very much at sort of tangible assets, our money as being our major, the thing that's most important to us. And of course, what money does, you know, is that it helps you to retire, but it doesn't help you to work longer. And to work longer, right the way through your life, you need to be building intangible assets. And we put these down. We would have three groups of intangible assets. Okay. The first is productivity, which is made up of having skills that are valuable at the time you need them. Having the relationships that help you to develop that, and also building your reputation. The second we call vitality, which is obviously health, but also the way you manage your work-life balance and how you build friendships. And then the third, which is something that I don't think that people have needed really up to now, but you've said it very clearly, is what we would call transformational assets, which is the asset that helps you to change. And we know, I speak as a psychologist, and we actually know quite a lot about personal transformation yet. Now, and we know that people change for two reasons, really. One is they understand themselves and what they need to do, which is why giving people some idea of the future is really important. And the second is that they have diverse networks, because actually it's very hard for you to change if you spend all your time with people just like you. It's actually when you spend time with people who are different that you say, I could be that person. Mm-hmm. And that's why this diversity is going to be really crucial. And I think we've built a way of measuring that. You can go to our website, www.100yearlife.com. Do it for free. 10,000 people have done it. And actually, we've been able, therefore, to look at how people are building, maintaining, or indeed depleting their asset base. And what you find, by the way, just as a measure of interest, is very little difference between age groups. This idea of, you know, older people not being interested in work or not being interested in learning, not being interested in vitality, we have no evidence of that. And then I'll finish. I do think age stereotyping is something that has to go if we want to encourage people to work into their 80s. We have ridiculous ideas about what it is to be 50, or I'm 60, 62, what it means to be 62. We've just got to let go of, we have to be age agnostic.
Yeah, you said that education has to be lifetime. And he's saying that the retraining training system in Canada is working. But do you think that, is that something that you can get to get transformed even when you get old?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think you know this very well. There's incredible data now that shows that our ideas about the aging brain were wrong. The brain is able to do all sorts of things. And by the way, the technology that's destroying people's jobs right now is also providing incredible opportunities for people to learn. And I think that one of the areas that's most interesting with regard to supporting people through a long life is the innovations that's happening in learning technologies, in virtual learning, and so on. So I think it's perfectly reasonable that every person here should be learning right the way through their life.
Get a load of this. Every year you delay retirement, you reduce the incidence of Alzheimer's by 3%. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So if you retire in 85 instead of 65, that's a 60% yeah. reduction in the incidence of Alzheimer's. So you don't use it, you lose it. And when we're talking lifespans, 8, 9, 10 decades, you got to use it.
Yeah.
But you know what's interesting about your point, which I love that categorization, is that we're all banking for retirement. And we all know how to look in our bank account. I've got $20,000, I have $30,000. But nobody's banking health for retirement.
Yeah. Mm.
How do you get a 30-year-old to change a behavior today that will make them live better when they're 70 or 80?
Yeah.
How do you get someone to start to practice prevention? Mm-hmm. You get sick, no matter what your age or how much you save, your retirement ain't fun. Mm. And so the challenge is to get people to start early, and to, whether it be the exercise, taking the baby aspirin, the statins, all the things that we know make you live longer and better. By the way, also help society and government lower costs. You know, if everybody would take a baby aspirin over the age of 40, in 20 years, 900,000 more people in the United States would be alive. We would save over $500 billion in healthcare costs. Mm-hmm. Yet we're not doing it. We all have a right to do what we want, but at some point we have to do the right thing.
Oh. So what are the right things other than the taking baby aspirin?
Well, number one is tobacco.
Tobacco?
Tobacco. Yeah. I mean, tobacco is an enormous percentage of cost, debility, and by the way, it's not the smoker only who pays, it's the rest of society, because in most of the countries, we subsidize people who are elderly on their health care. So tobacco is a major one. It's movement over time is critical. Is diet, is keeping lean body mass, is keeping the brain going. It's having fun, enjoying life. Mm-hmm. It's having a spouse. People with a spouse live longer. You know, but if we're talking all of these things, and we have...
Women don't. It's true.
No, I agree. We have technology now, you know, that can literally use the immune system to take care of cancer. Mm-hmm. We can delay heart disease and stroke by decades by the medicines we have now. And so the challenge is that's a dramatic different change. We're not going to be treating like we have been 40, 50, 60-year-olds, but we're going to be treating 80, 90-year-olds.
Mm-hmm.
How do we change society in that regard?
Yes.
And, you know, I'm a believer that we need to think forward. The medical revolution has happened. We're all going to benefit if we act now and practice prevention. But at the same time, we need you guys to figure out the rest of it. We can wear the help part.
Can I ask one question to him?
Mm-hmm.
I've touched upon the sort of the health disparity.
Mm-hmm.
Even if the technology will help the longer life, but the question is that who can have the benefit from this new technology? This is a big social issue, I think. If the only the rich can have this kind of treatment, that's create another wealth disparity.
It's a great question. So, you know, there's a pill a day that if you take it, reduces not the incidence, but the death rate of cancer by 30%, heart disease by 22%, and stroke by 17%.
Mm-hmm.
This pill is 2,433 years old. Hippocrates said, you take the bark of the willow tree and chew it, pain and fever go away. It's called a baby aspirin. So for $3 a year, you can reduce the death rate of cancer by 30%. And it's a staggering number. Then you take the Lipitor-like drugs, statins. They will delay heart attack and stroke in someone with a normal cholesterol by over a decade. And without health insurance, they're $9 for a 90-day supply.
Really?
Mm-hmm. So they're not expensive. And the beauty of these new technologies that are happening now is they're democratizing health.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
I think in today's world, it used to be that if you know, Angelina Jolie went out there like a hero and she said, I have the mutant gene for breast cancer. And at the time, it was $6,000 to sequence a gene.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, you had to pay a ransom to look at your own DNA. Well, the Supreme Court in the United States said you can no longer patent a gene.
Mm.
So now that predatory practice, that monopolistic practice is gone,
uh-huh.
and now it's $100 to look at your own gene. And that number is falling year by year. So I think these technologies that are happening now are going to be democratized.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what's going to actually equalize health over time.
That's important.
Well, talking about the technology, I think you mentioned in your book, Lucky Years, that because we are lucky, because of the unprecedented access to the information, such as big data, right?
No question about it. I mean, big data is changing everything. I mean, we talked about that delaying retirement. There's a study in Europe, the largest study ever done in Europe, where they showed how close you live to an airport. And the closer you live to an airport, the higher the rate of brain decline as you get older, implying that our brain needs quiet at night when we sleep. So if you live in a city, if you live near an airport, I have a 150-pound dog that snores, and I can't kick her out of the bedroom. So I wear those orange foam earplugs at night. And that thinking forward is not only saving my health, but it's helping society in the long run. The care of somebody with Alzheimer's is hundreds of thousands of dollars per year. And so me wearing those foam earplugs makes some major impact there. And at the same time, this is the era of big data, is that we all have the opportunity of being part of the cure, of letting our data be used to help others. And we're going to find, discovery by discovery, we just found last year that if you had ovarian cancer and you want a beta blocker, which is an inexpensive drug for blood pressure, you live 4.5 years longer. We would have never found that from biology, but we found it from big data. And we're going to get question by question answer with the big data if we do it right.
But who can keep control? Who manages that big data? I mean, a lot of private information.
Well, your business, the financial institutions, 20 years, you're not going to manage the data, don't worry. 20 years ago, you guys said, listen, let's all do data standards. And what do you know? Now I can, with a credit card, buy something in Japan and have it shipped to my house. We all talk the same language. So first in our field, we need those data standards. We need that same language.
Oh, I see.
And then we need groups, nonprofits, who can guard privacy, who can protect it so that this data, you're not afraid of people using it, and they take away your identifier, so I don't know it's you, and at the same time, use it for good and not for bad. You don't want your health data to say, you know, listen, I know you broke your leg, here's a pair of pants that's larger. We don't want that, but we want to know better ways to treat and prevent disease, and so we need to form new nonprofits to do it, because it's probably not the role of government, and it's clearly not the role of for-profits.
I see.
Well, Mr. Kohno, we provide the news financial services in Japan, starting from this spring, which is the to gathering the health care health data from individual and to put in our company and to research it. And if the health condition is well, we can provide the better interest rate to him or whatever.
Wow.
This is a sort of the intangible asset of individual.
Yeah.
The key point of this service
is, I love that, by the way.
Why don't you use that? Is that the voluntary the person would like to willingly to provide the his own health data. That's a key of the privacy issues to use the big data.
Yeah. It's incentivizing. I mean, that's a remarkable incentive. Companies incentivizing employees and saying, you know, listen, if you smoke, you're allowed to smoke in your company, but we're going to charge you 3 times the health insurance cost because that's what it costs us. And do the non-smokers want to subsidize the smokers? And when you put it like that, you know, it's interesting. Companies did that and they got upset. Then they said, listen, we'll give a discount to the non-smokers. So the same economics, and nobody was upset.
Oh, yeah. I think this issue of consequences is really important, actually, because I run a one-week program at London Business School for my students, which is about the future and this sort of stuff. And we use the diagnostic of intangible assets. And one of the things I say to them, look, you could be my age and be a billionaire, but you may not have what I've got, which is one of my important assets, which is a lifetime friend. I've had a friend that we just recently celebrated 50 years of friendship. And that's an asset, and you've got to do it now. You can't at the age of 70 say, I want a lifelong friend. You actually have to start investing when you're young. And I think this is really important for governments as well, to help people realize it's not just about health, early investments, or about savings. It's actually about friendships. What's very interesting about the intangible assets that we describe is going through every single one of them, productivity, vitality, transformation, is what psychologists would call social capital. You know, the friendships, the communities. People will not live long lives on their own. They live them with other people. And we need to be much clearer, I think, the role that communities and neighborhoods play, which, of course, in Japan, you're very sensitive to, in helping people live long, productive lives.
Is there anything?
I don't know if we're going to be able to legislate friendships.
Oh.
It's a new potential idea. But what we can do, I mean, there's many things we can do, of course,
anybody
to help.
Trudeau can. So.
Yeah, there you go. We've got a great spokesperson for that, for sure. You know, reducing anxiety is a big part of what government can do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the challenge is that the anxiety is likely to get greater. I mean, the World Economic Forum and Mercer put out a study showing that there's a $70 trillion deficit in retirement funding right now, which is likely to go to $400 trillion in 2050. And that sort of, those numbers give, obviously, societies and individuals pause. So from our standpoint, we do need to think about how we can alleviate that anxiety, which will allow people to pursue the things that they want to pursue during the course of their lives. For us, as we think about retirement, notwithstanding the, you know, my agreement that we're going to have to rethink how we do it, we need to acknowledge that some people won't be able to work until they're 85. So we need to create the underpinning as a government of how people can feel secure at the end of their career. So for us, the way we're thinking about this is ensuring that we provide the support for people, especially in jobs that are challenging, that you know, people might not be able to work as long. Mm-hmm. So people who are often in lower income situation or in middle income situation, the idea of trying to find ways to augment their retirement income while creating incentives for those that perhaps are going to be more able to transition to new careers or different jobs, means, you know, you deal with the fact that you have some people who won't be able to work longer, and also encourage others to work longer. And that's the path we're trying to go on. We're likely to see later retirement. In fact, in Canada, it's now moved from 61 a decade ago to about 64 now, just 64. Because of the aging of the baby boomers. And that's a trend that's going to continue for those people that want to continue to work. Our job is to encourage that, to create an underpinning so that people have some sense of security if they're not able to stay in the workforce, and to help to find ways to get them to stay in the workforce as much as possible, because after we take the baby aspirin and put the things in our ears, we still do need to have that something that engages us every day, and that's important.
Yeah. Great.
And, you know, one of the ways that we help people stay in the workforce is we change work. And that's really what corporations need to do. So, you know, if I said to anyone in this audience, you're going to work nonstop just as you do now to the age of 80, all of us would say, I couldn't possibly do that. But if you say you're going to work till 80, but, you know, you'll be taking gap years like your 20-year-old is, or you'll be taking time off to do things, or there'll be times when you only work 3 days a week, then suddenly it all seems possible. And I think that we've got to, and this is a real plea to corporations, corporations have really got to think hard about the way they structure work and their expectations of how people work.
Mr. Sato, is there anything that the business sector can do to secure the job for the elderly?
Well, sure. I'd like to introduce the project, specific project we are now working on that, which is called the Healthcare Point Project. I myself and also government are involved in that. The system of this Healthcare Point Project is that to gather the health condition from the people living in that society or even in the company. Then we have known the current status of the health condition. Once the employee or the people living there will have the more exercise or more health care to create the good number on the health condition, then company or even the local government will provide the monetary incentive to them. So give them the sort of the monetary paper or whatever, to be able to use that paper in that area only. So there are a couple benefits from this project. One, of course, the create a better condition of the individuals or even employees, create more productivity for the company. And second, to be able to reduce the significant amount of the healthcare expenses. Third, to use this kind of monetary paper to be able to stimulate the economy in that the region. So nothing worse. Mm-hmm. Yeah. this is a very limited project now, but now Japanese companies step into this project, which is one of the good solution, a very concrete idea to be able to overcome it.
What do you think of it?
I think it's a brilliant idea, because I think one of the challenges we all face is that we know we shouldn't have that, you know, great big lovely piece of chocolate cake, and we know we should be saving, but humans actually are, you know this better than I, our brains really...
I'm not against chocolate cake.
you don't look as if you're eating a lot of it. But, you know, cognitively, we're really all cognitively wired to want to get everything right now. So the idea of thinking long term is not something which humans find easy. So we have to find all sorts of ways of nudging us. I think this is a great idea. One of the ways that we nudge our students on our program is we ask them very concretely to imagine their 80-year-old self sitting right next to them and say, what would your 80-year-old self say now to the decisions that you are now making? Now, that we know that that increases people's savings rates marginally. But actually, showing people the consequences at every stage of their life of the behaviors that they're doing, I think is absolutely crucial.
Mm-hmm. We do it one step further. We have a virtual reality thing we're working on now.
Yes.
We can get kids and show them what it's like when it's 80 years old.
Yeah.
So first of all, they learn empathy, but then they also learn to protect their joints and not to do the things that are going to cause a problem, so they can't walk when they're 70 or 80, but to imagine it.
Right. Yes.
And so, I mean, it's a key thing, is how do you get a 20-year-old to change a behavior that affects them when they're 80?
Yeah.
But that's the challenge in health. There's that time lag. And that time lag is a killer.
And that's not just a health challenge. I mean, that's a savings challenge.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because you say, actually, you're 20 and you realize you didn't save your 80-year-old. And it's a productivity. Do you realize that now you're 80, you don't have any skills because you didn't put a time aside to learn anything? So the more that we can be age agnostic and realize that we have to, at every stage, develop ourselves, then I think we're in a much better shape.
Well, then there's the other side, right? We all have the right to do what we want. We can smoke, we can sit all day, we can drink sodas all day. But does society or companies have the obligation for paying for the healthcare ramifications of what we do?
Mm-hmm.
It's a critical question we need to put out there.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me ask about the inequality issue that Mr. Sato mentioned. Professor Gratton, do you think that the difference in income level affecting the life expectancy?
Yes, I mean, the data is very clear on that. Even, for example, in the UK, right now in the UK, rich people live 12 years longer than poor people. And actually, I think the difficulty there is that if it was, if rich people got paid more, which of course they do, we could use taxation as a way of distributing money. But of course, we can't. There's no mechanism to distribute years. I mean, no one can take my years from me and give it to somebody else.
Is there a step function? Is there a minimum income you need to get that?
There is a step function. So yes, I mean, that's the reality right now. And of course, from a government perspective, and we've been talking to the UK government, the worst possible outcome, which you alluded to earlier, is that you push the retirement rate up, and people who are going to die 10 years earlier means that they never retire. Mm. So this is, you know, you face a real sort of philosophical challenge here. That actually you push retirement age up, which you really have to do, but actually because longevity isn't given to everyone, then there's a possibility that people will work all their life and never retire.
No, there is it's very clear that there's an issue around inequality in that sense as well. So trying to find a way to engage people to stay working, of course, is great for labor force productivity. We need that. With declining workforces, we're very challenged economically. But doing it in a way that inappropriately or really hurts people who are at the lower end of the income scale is another cause for what we're seeing in our societies right now, a sense of a concern that the benefits of growth aren't going to all cohorts of society. So that's one of the things that we're thinking about as we think about our retirement challenges, is ensuring that we help people save more, which we want to do, ensuring that there's incentives for people to stay in the workforce, so not creating a retirement system that gives people an incentive to retire when they're still able and available to work. But recognizing that for those people that can't continue working, for those people that are lower in the income scale, if we arbitrarily change their age of retirement to make it higher, we're basically taking from the poorest and moving it to the wealthiest. Mm-hmm. So that arbitrary move on age of retirement is effectively regressive taxation. Mm-hmm. And so it's something to be concerned with. Because the broader framework, of course, that we're facing in Canada, that clearly other industrialized countries are facing, is a sense from the middle class that they're not seeing the same gains as other parts of society. And that in and of itself is a potential breakdown that we don't really have any remedies for.
We understand that the provincial government of Ontario will going to start a pilot project for the universal basic income. Is that right?
I heard that. Canada is a federal country where we have provinces and a federal government, and it's healthy actually that we get experiments in different parts of the country. Mm-hmm. So the Ontario government is looking at a small scale guaranteed annual income experiment, like what's happening in other places in the world.
Yeah.
We've taken a slightly different approach federally. We came into office with an objective of dealing with the sense of gains being differently distributed and causing concern for citizens. So what we did is we actually just lowered middle class taxes. So we lowered taxes on 9 million Canadians. And we raised taxes on the top 1%. So there was a redistributive element of what we did immediately on coming in. And then we took a look at some of our programs that are universal. We had a universal child care benefit, and we means tested it. So we significantly increased the amount of child care benefit for lower and middle income Canadians up to, it's means tested away by about $175,000 in annual income. And we did that by taking it from the people at the top end and actually adding more money for that group. So I think, as you think about elements like this, these are actually ways to help people to be engaged in the workforce. Because if you have higher child benefits for families, it allows more women to be in the workforce. It allows more choices at that age and stage. There was certainly a redistributive element of it, which is important because if people believe that they're seeing technology change or globalization that's not benefiting them, then in the long run, we just don't have the societal consensus to move forward on things that can help us to grow, help us to be wealthier.
Can I add some things to on that matter? As all of you know, there's this kind of the inequality or wealth disparity is the biggest issue for all the world. Of course, the Brexit is related to this inequality, and Mr. Trump's election is also, and IS also is related to this disparity. Mm. I think the key point of this issue is quite related to the new shape of the capitalism. Used to be we rely on the sort of invisible God's hand to have appropriate the portion of the people. But we may not be able to rely on this invisible God's hand. So which means that we have to enhance the government's role, which is the wealth or income redistribution function. Okay, I believe that. But this creates another issue, which is, I think two issues are in front of us. One is that, once again, silver democracy issue. But the other one is we may lose the social vitality if we enhance the government's role on this redistribution function. Likewise, the basic income, which is good, which is bad, which is something like socialism, would be losing some vitality to grow. So every country has to decide or find out the appropriate level of the function of the government distribution function. That's a very important issue.
Yes.
Yeah, and I think that you know, I think there's going to be a lot more conversations about the basic income. But it seems to me, just looking at how the 100-year life plays out, that a really important government intervention is around helping people start their own businesses. Because it's sort of, it seems self-evident that you're not going to be able to live, work in a large corporation all your life. So part of the new stage that we imagine might emerge, apart from the explorer and the, someone working a portfolio, is actually the independent producer. And whilst technology is destroying many jobs, it's also giving opportunities for people to be independent producers. And I think that government, particularly in Japan, for example, where you have a low rate of entrepreneurial development, the Japanese government has a real role there to support young people and middle-aged people and old people to start their own business. And that actually creates, that takes away some of the anxieties. I think the anxiety that we face is in part because you're expecting somebody else to do something for you, to give you a job. But if we could empower people to start building their own businesses using the technology platforms that we're now, that are being innovated, then I think that's, that would be also an interesting way for government intervention.
Right. We're talking about the government, Dr. Agus. Do you think the government is doing enough for the society, aging society? Please tell us from your medical standpoint.
You know, it's a very obviously loaded question. You know, government in most countries pays for healthcare of as you get older. They say do whatever you want, and then we'll pay once you get 65 or whatever age in that country. And they give minimum healthcare, and I think that's fine. But I think, you know, what was alluded to before is, you know, to me, retirement is not a physiologic process; it's a chronologic process. And so, you know, when you look at the skill set that you've acquired over time, you lose some skills and you gain many others. And so we have to start to better quantify them, and we have to start to move forward and develop workforce needs that fit those requirements. Because clearly, you look 20 years ago, people did retire at 65, and that's how society was structured. But now they're going 65, 75, 85. We need to change the medical system, and we need to change the job system to take advantage of that remarkable asset, which are brains with four decades of experience. That's an asset, not a liability. And we're treating it as a liability of a place to put them. And so I think it really is a change in mindset that we have to do. And it's very hard to get governments to think more than in four-year scans, right? Why should I do something today that's going to help 10 years from now or 20 years from now? But we have to change that time scale of government intervention because we'll all benefit.
What do you think, your politicians, you only think about 3 or 4 years?
Spend. Well, you know,
no offense,
none taken. We, you know,
you're the exception.
One of the things that we talked about in our country was a first initiative for us was enhancing our pension plan, and we did it in a way that actually is not going to help me at age 54. It's going to help my, you know, my 20-year-old and my 19-year-old and my 18-year-old. So that was actually a pretty long-term view. We did it though because we thought it was the right thing. We also see that it's actually part of a set of measures that are going to give people more ability to be engaged and effective today, and be part of you know, part of a society that's, you know, that's presumably going to be better for all of them. So I think government can take long-term decisions, but you probably do need to link it back to the challenges we're facing today. The challenge that we were seeing today was that the young people of today just aren't saving enough, and they're starting to recognize that as a challenge. That's gives us the ability to actually make impact on this right now. So that it's a question of framing, and you know, even forums like this are helpful for that framing.
Dr. Agus, but the talking about the incentive for preventions, who has to encourage that? I mean, the government has to be involved, or the corporation, or?
Well, you look at corporations. I mean, what does your corporation spend on health? What percent of your revenue is health?
Well, I think just about 2%, 3% level.
So 3%. Most companies in the United States, that number is 17%. So 17%. So a much higher number. And so when you look at companies, I mean, I believe every company should have a chief health officer whose job it is to help the employees live better, live longer, because it'll help the bottom line is the company. as well as really set the stage for a more productive workforce going forward. Mm. At the same time, governments need to do those incentives also, because they take over the bill later on. More than half the healthcare in the United States is paid for by our federal government. That number is even higher in your country, obviously.
Well, it is, but of course, part of what our government is paying for is what companies are not having to charge.
No question, but so in your country, you say, listen, you could smoke your whole life, and then we'll still pay, which it's going to cost three times as much, but right. We'll pay, and you don't smoke, we'll pay a much lower price. And to me, there's an inequality there, mm-hmm. and that's an inequality we have to address and really isn't being talked about as much as it should.
Well, that's 17% include the social security expenses, probably.
No, I mean, it's healthcare costs. Healthcare costs in the United States are 17% of GDP.
Yeah. Really?
And so when you look at company by company, it's approximately
that's
that.
Amazing. That's an amazing number.
Yeah.
Now, we have discussed the role of the government and the corporations so far, but how we should, I mean, as individuals, mm-hmm. right, think about it and having an aging society.
Yeah, I think, well, in the end, and actually you've made the point very eloquently, I think in the end, it is individuals responsible, and it seems to me that as we look at what will happen over the next 5 to 10 years, I think individuals will try and make their own lives as productive as possible, and then corporations will catch up and governments will catch up. What should individuals do? They should think about tangible and intangible assets. I mean, we did a lot of work in the book simply to get that framing right. Productivity, vitality, transformation. And they should be measuring that just as they're measuring their heartbeat.
That's the key. You know, mm-hmm. game theory says you need a parameter from which to optimize. And I love all those concepts, but I don't know what parameter to optimize on. I don't have a number on my watch.
Well, there is. You see, this is it. And this is what we're actually looking for people to work with us on this. But you can do that. You can actually measure intangible assets. And we're doing some research next year, actually, with three big Dutch companies, where we're going to use surveys. I mean, this is the sort of thing you would love in terms of human capital, just to see if we can get the same level of granularity. Because I agree that then you say, when we do this with our students, they say, oh, my God, my networks are really low at the moment. And this is what we need. We need people to realize you are now depleting the asset. It's okay to deplete it for a period of time, but actually, you have got to, at some stage, start really developing the asset. And what we realize, actually, when we think, apart from the baby aspirin, most investments in individual assets require time. It's about the allocation of time. You know, time to exercise, time to spend time with friends, time to learn. So what we're also doing is helping people realize that the allocation of time is a very important, time is an attribute that they have to work with.
So what the people should do, from a doctor's point of view,
I love the
how the individuals
so
have to do to help their save the life.
Well, I think they have to make a strategic plan for their own health, make a 1, 5, 10, and 20-year horizon for their own health. And it focuses mainly on prevention. It is so much easier to prevent a disease than to treat it. We can prevent more than half cancers. We can delay heart disease and stroke easily by over a decade, decade and a half of most people, yet we're not doing it. And so those are the relatively simple things. And at the same time, companies have to redefine their workplace. You know, our bodies were designed to move. Yeah. So movement over time equals health. And I love this thing as we're all sitting down. But if you sit for 5 hours, it's the same as smoking a pack of cigarettes. Mm. So why do people have a printer at their desk? It should be the other side of the office. Every time, get up and encourage the movements. You know, I used to go, visit Steve Jobs, and we always went for a walk. And he goes, there are two reasons for the walk. He goes, one is the health reason. He said, the other is if you go for a walk and you get to the corner, and you know if you're going to turn left or right, but the other person doesn't, it gives you an advantage in the business negotiations.
So that's interesting.
Well, I'm for one, I'm really glad I haven't done my New Year's resolutions yet.
What is it?
I'm going to nurture that friend that I had from the time I was five. I'm going to focus on my already good marriage. I'm going to take baby aspirins. I'm going to buy those things for my ears. I've got a few, important action steps that I'm going to take. But from a government standpoint, we are really going to be very focused on how we can help individuals and help companies and broadly help society to think about how they can be more effectively engaged in the workforce. Mm-hmm. So it's about labor force information for people. Mm-hmm. It's getting that information out. It's rethinking the education and training so that we allocate training dollars to the places mm-hmm. where it can have the biggest impact. And you know, these are the things that we know that we can do that will enhance labor force productivity, engagement and productivity. And then what we're going to think about is those particular subsets in our population. I'm sure it's the same for other countries that have underrepresentation in the labor force. So in Canada, we still have underrepresentation by women. We still have underrepresentation by you know, our indigenous peoples. We have underrepresentation by you know, recent immigrants. So there are things that we can do that can have a fairly fast impact, and things that are going to take longer. That are going to help people over the entire span of what will be a longer workforce, workplace participation.
Okay. It seems time is running out, unfortunately. So I would like to give you, each of you, probably the hardest question at this session. What would you hope to do when you are to live to 100? Starting with you, sir.
You know, it's interesting. I reevaluated, you know, when I was turning to 30. So I changed the sports I play. So I play tennis now because it's a sport I can play until my 90s. I used to like basketball, but you can't keep going on that. I started to write because, again, writing is something I can do forever. I see patients now, and I'll continue to do that through my 90s. You know, many other things I'll probably give up, particularly the travel. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I want to keep this brain active. I love it. Mm-hmm. And it's a privilege to do what I do. And, you know, what I tell all the young people who work for us is find your passion. You know, nowadays, careers are going to last 70 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you got to be passionate about it or you ain't going to do it.
Mr. Morneau?
Well, I'm loving what I'm doing right now. You know, being in a role where you have the potential to have impact on your whole population is very exciting. Mm-hmm. Probably not something that you could sustain the pace of for the whole next hopefully 30 or 40 years. So, I think you know the idea of being engaged and impactful in different ways over time, mm-hmm. Taking the kind of experience that you might get for me in this role by talking about it or writing about it mm-hmm. afterwards would be interesting. Also thinking about how you can use that experience, you know, in my case, to potentially have, you know, more granular impact on specific topics that that I might have gotten time to look at, but only very quickly because mm-hmm. the nature of a government role is there's an awful lot of information coming sure. at you very rapidly and you can't go that deep. So, you know, maybe that's the next iteration. You know, I hope I have it.
Great. Mr. Sato?
Yeah, I used to play guitar in my young age, but I want to play piano, so
wow.
I'd like to learn it. And also, I'd like to have more close communication and connection to the local community. Well, I have big shock from the big earthquake and tsunami year 2011. The people living in that area surprised the world people because the people who has been losing their parents, but they are trying to help the others. Okay, that kind of behavior is quite related to the new behavior at the 1 year's lifetime, which means that too much concern on the connection with the local community or to have strong concern on the live together, save together. I think this is the quite important hint to survive in 1 year's life. That's my concern.
Mm. That's very good.
Well, we're very fortunate because both of us are professors, and you can work forever at the university. It's amazing. You just never ever get kicked out.
You don't
out.
Have retirement.
We don't have any concept of retirement, and I consider myself very fortunate about that. And I would like other people to be really fortunate. So I'm going to, in the next couple of years, carry on this theme of longevity, and we're going to look at what corporations and governments can do. We're just launching a big research project on that. So that will keep me going way into my mid 70s.
Okay, so thank you very much. This concludes the session. Thank you. Thanks for participating.
You did
well, thank you.